Hello everybody! In this video, I will show you how to take a picture reference and transform it into a cartoon character. Very important, what we're gonna see here will build upon three prior videos where I show you a fairly unique method to study and draw characters. Link to all of them in the description. Make sure to give them a quick watch, they're super short and to the point, and they will give you the context you need to understand everything here. One final warning before starting. This video is taken directly out of an upcoming course I'm working on, the same with the other videos, so keep that in mind. And speaking of the course I'm working on, if you would like to help me during the production and get the course for free once it's ready, right now I'm making my special All Courses bundle available again. That's 10 full courses, plus the new one on character design, background design, game art and Inkscape, about 70 plus hours of content, all for 19 bucks. It's only for a limited time until I finish the course. After that, the bundle will be no longer available, and those who purchase it will get this new course for free in an update. That was all. Let's continue with the lesson. Let's begin with the most straightforward way to make a character using our system, and that is applying the explorative study method to a real-life picture, like we did in the cartooning lesson, but applied to the whole body, to make a whole character. This method, in my opinion, has its drawbacks, as you'll see later on in the lesson, but it can be a great starting point to make your own characters. Plus, we are gonna build upon this for the more advanced methods of character creation we are gonna see in future lessons. By now, you probably know the drill. We start gathering reference, this time real-life pictures. But here are some tips and just things to keep in mind at the moment of picking the right reference. First of all, because now you do are making your own characters, and chances are you may want to show them, you'll want to pay special attention to the copyright of the reference. Most of the time you will not have any problem for as long as you stay away from copyrighted characters or costumes, like cosplays or pictures taken from a production, which may result in an accidental cartoon version of an already existing character. Ideally, you'd want a picture taken by you, of yourself or a friend. This way you are making sure everything is okay legally, but of course most people don't have pirates or Viking costumes ready to be used at any moment. So just be careful of what picture you're using. Make some light investigation before you start drawing. And one final thing related to that, I know this is a bit of a controversial topic, but searching for reference on Pinterest, I found out a lot of the best references were created with AI. I don't know how you feel personally about using AI as an artist, but in the case of using it for reference, that might be just the most ethically correct use you could give it right now, at least in my opinion. This way, you could avoid any copyright problem and get the exact thing you need, but it's up to you if you feel that's an acceptable use case or not. Continuing with more artistic tips, make sure you get a reference of a full body, so you have all the information you need. Don't invent anything. We'll leave that for the next lesson. Be careful of references with tons of clothes and folds. Clothing is a subject to study on its own, just like anatomy. We don't need that extra complexity right now. Don't skip fabric with folds, but if you see too much complexity going on, maybe switch to another reference. A bit more on anatomy. Avoid reference where there is a lot of the body showing, at least for now. Later on we'll see more about this. And also related, the head, the face, we haven't seen that yet, so I recommend you to skip references that show the face too much. Of course, I don't mean you should go get references of decapitated people, but perhaps you want to study references that have the face covered, at least partially with helmets or hoods. At least for now, until we see the face in more detail later on. Though you can always just not draw the face. And the final tip, this has to do more with the whole process rather than the first step of gathering references. If you see that you cannot properly cartoonize a full body reference, maybe the problem is the particular reference you gathered. Try another one. It has happened to me that some pictures, for some reason, seems like they are easy to study, but then you try to cartoonize it, and it just doesn't look good. Maybe it's an issue with the reference, or perhaps a tricky pose, or maybe something that just falls out of your current knowledge. Don't sweat it, that happens to me all the time. just try with another reference. Let's see a quick example. I know you've done this a ton of times and you probably don't need an example, but you haven't seen how to apply it to a full character of your own, so let's look at a quick one. If you remember in the cartooning lesson, I mentioned a technique to solve the problems of transforming a real-life thing into a cartoon, before you start with the variations. Rewatch that lesson if you need. This technique is super simple. Just trace over and find what is going to be deleted and what's going to be left. And it's done. This is the drawing we will be making variations on. This is our new reference. We don't need the real-life picture anymore. This should be easier to draw, because it's the same as the other cartoon explorations we've been doing so far, only that this time you made a cartoon. Because most humanoid characters are gonna be kinda complex, most likely you'll need to use the layering method, and depending on the complexity of some areas, you may need to use the focusing method. Remember, some of the common areas of complexity tend to be the hands and feet and head. We're not doing heads right now, and the hands and feet of this character are not that complicated, so we are doing just two simple layers. Now it's time for the variations. I'll be doing just three to demonstrate, but as always, the more you do, the better they'll come up. Now it's just the exact same process than before. First the layers, and then you build from there. While I'm finishing the drawings, I would like to go over a few things to keep in mind when making characters using this method. First of all, after you finish your first variations, you will start to see the limitations of using a single reference. The problem is that what looks good in real life does not always translate that good to a cartoon. Real life has a ton of small little details that keep the eye occupied and make something cool, while the same things in a cartoon can end up feeling distracting. And this results in a drawing that feels either empty or that lacks something. At this stage, every part of my artist brain is telling me to start doing something with these empty spaces, to start adding maybe some inner details or start drawing something else here and there. But I want to stay to what we are seeing in this lesson, so I'm not gonna. Using a single reference can be a great starting point, but if you want something that looks better, more unique and more in control over how it looks, you'll need to complement it with other references. I originally planned to go over that here in this lesson, but it came up too lengthy and I like my lessons to be laser focused. So we're gonna see that in the next one. For now, let's move on to the summary and the exercises. The most straightforward method to create a cartoon character using our explorative study method is by using it with real-life reference. Gather pictures of real-life people in costumes or just normal people that you think will make for a good cartoon, and proceed with an explorative study using everything we've seen so far. Using real-life reference, however, can bring in some pains, like for example copyrighted images or reference with things we haven't seen so far, like folds or anatomy, which you should avoid for now. Also, if a particular reference gives you too much trouble, consider just trying another one. Sometimes it just happens. Copying real-life reference can be hard, and sometimes the reference is not cooperating, so don't sweat it. At the moment of making the study, remember that everything we saw applies here as well. But you may want to check out again that lesson on cartooning real-life reference. Also, if the end result is less than impressive, or just don't look or feel as good as the reference, that's normal. Often real-life reference does not have the same amount of information a cartoon would need. That's why you may be tempted to invent something to fill the empty space or just add some extra stuff. A direct implementation of a real-life reference may not look 100% correct all the time, that's why you usually do not use a single reference, but more on that later. For the exercises, I think you know what it's gonna be. Just gather a suitable real-life reference. Of course, I mean a full body of a character, and adapt it to a cartoon. Do at least 10 studies with at least 5 variations each. If you want, you can invent new things to supply any fault you see in the adaptation, that's fine, but usually I don't recommend you to just invent stuff, at least for now. If the end result looks empty, just accept it and in the next lesson I'll show you how to fix that. I decided to record the rendering on Inkscape because I realized most of my subscribers are here for Inkscape, not for the basics of drawing. So I thought to add this section to this video, which won't be on the course version, and that hopefully will give you a more complete picture of how to sketch out characters and then move them to Inkscape to finish them. So here are all the images imported and ready to be used inside of Inkscape. I will be rendering the three of them at the same time, and I hate to send you to yet another video, but I did upload it to my channel a full course on how to do this, how to render and finish sketches in Inkscape. I will leave you the link below. That will get you up and running with everything I'm doing now. Though I'm not gonna go in depth into anything in this video, I just thought that video could help you. But just to summarize what I'm doing here, I lowered the opacity of the layer with the reference I'm gonna trace, and locked the layer so I can't interact with it anymore. And because we're gonna use fill shapes, I created another layer and sent it below. I'm gonna work on that layer. Because the reference layer above is transparent, due to the lower opacity, I can still see what I'm tracing as I'm working with the fill shapes. That is a nice hack I love to use. I'm tracing using closed shapes mainly because I plan to work on all three variations at the same time, and I do plan to reuse as much as I can. You'll notice that I'm doing one part and then adapting that part to all the other variations, since it's basically the same shapes but with different proportions. This saves me a lot of time, and the more variations I'd had to trace, the more time I'd save. If you're interested in learning the specifics of how to reuse shapes and adapt them to different variations, check out this video in particular. Notice that first I'm tracing over on the realistic version. There is no specific reason to do this, I just wanted to see how the realistic looking version would look, so I thought to start there. I love making the rendering in Inkscape because, believe it or not, this is the easiest and most mindless part of the whole deal. The sketch was the hardest part. Now all you have to do is to fix and retouch a few technical inaccuracies that it may have. The fact that we are working with a vector software and with the mouse, to me, it helps me to take this part much more easy. I don't feel that I have to be perfect with the line, and I can edit and adjust as much as I want. So if I had to choose, I will always pick rendering in a vector software and with a keyboard and mouse, rather than using a traditional raster software. And here I would like to repeat something I briefly mentioned in the first video. I tend to make the sketches here much more clean than they are necessary. I do this mostly so it looks better on video, but everything I'm drawing, including all variations you've seen, made both on paper and on Inkscape, are just sketches, a quick drawing made for the purpose of learning, or in this case, meant to be refined later on. My sketches aren't the most clean or finished pieces ever, but still you certainly can go much more rough than what I do with them. Okay, color. I quickly searched for reference in Pinterest. I wanted to give it a cartoon version of the same colors from the image, and I got a couple of references that use similar color schemes, just to have a direction to start picking the colors. I'm not entirely happy with them, I feel I could just experiment more, but I'm satisfied and I think they work with the characters. And now for the shadow. This is where it will give it that 3D look and that clean finish. Basically it's the same technique as always, a dark blue color with low opacity, implying a top right light, a few contact shadows, and of course the black outline I love so much. And this is it for this video. I hope this extra Inkscape section has demonstrated the type of illustration you can easily come up with using a single reference and my explorative copy method. In the course, I will go much more in depth to what we've seen, so if you're interested, make sure to get my courses bundle while you can. The truth is that I have some personal issues that have prevented me from working on the new course as much as I wanted. I did not delay it on purpose. I'm working really hard so I can finish it as soon as possible. That was everything for now. I hope these videos have been of help. See you next week for a new tutorial on Inkscape and illustration. Bye!